pursuing my dream. You know, I was pursuing my dream of becoming a professional poker player. And as hard as it was really great to be doing it with the woman that I would eventually marry, and in a city that I fell in love with, in a game I was falling in love with. I'ma give it all I got, all I got, like grinding every day, ain't no other way. All right, welcome to the very first episode of Embrace the Grind, the Embrace the Grind show, something that I've been wanting to do for a long time. And this is extra special for me because I'm not only here with today's guest, I'm hoping that this actually turns into a co-host situation, but I need to introduce you because I've been in front of the camera a lot. A lot of the audience probably knows who I am, but they might not know who you are. So with me today, joining me today is my brother, Andrew Moreno, poker player.
What's up, bro?
Poker player extraordinaire, been on the grind for over 15 years.
Close to 20,
been in the industry forever. You've dabbled in some ventures within poker. You've quit a time or two, gotten back in, felt like you were going to give up. But here we are almost 20 years later. You've crushed all the way up to the high stakes. You've made probably close to $1 million in cashes on the Hendon Mob, which is basically the scoreboard for tournament poker players. You've definitely made a name for yourself within poker, even though I've been in front of the camera more and Chrissy's been in front of the camera more. Actually, talk a little bit about that, being behind the scenes and actually being the most accomplished player in the family unit, but yet the least known one.
Yeah, I mean, the first thing I could definitely say, I have to take a moment and just kind of take this in because, I mean, you know, growing up together, you being my older brother and watching you do your thing has been so much fun for me. Both you and Christy, it's been, you know, a lot of people have asked me, oh, why don't you get in there? Why don't you do video and, you know, talk on camera and get on the video things? But, you know, realistically, I've just been loving consuming your guys' content and following you. I'm just so proud of you and Christy for what you guys have been able to create. And, I just wanted to take a moment and just kind of celebrate that because, you know, it's kind of crazy that I'm here now doing this with you when I like think about our whole journey. But as far as poker goes, I guess I would definitely was the one that kind of started us out. You know, I'm 37 now and I started playing when I was 18, 19 years old. So poker's changed a lot since then.
Definitely. And yeah. I remember when you first started playing, I was not into it, you know, because the way that we grew up a little bit lower income and we weren't exposed to gambling within our family. It was every dollar that we got went into the family and like trying to survive. So the thought of even gambling a single dollar was just so, it was so foreign for us. So I remember when I had, cause I did the traditional route, you know, I went to college, got the 2-year degree, went into computer science. And I basically was like, that's what you got to do, bro. Cause like, if we're gonna make money and we're gonna escape kind of the lifestyle that we're in, got to go to school. That was the conventional wisdom. And when you started playing poker, I definitely was not having it at first.
Yeah. And you know what too? It was such a source of pride for the family. I mean, you went to college, you got a degree, you got a good job for a big company as a computer developer or web developer, right?
Yep, yep.
And, you know, I just remember our parents, they would glow when they would talk about you and you were making good money and you were, you know, had all the trappings of success. You had a nice car, you had a good job. And I definitely felt kind of on the outside of that, you know, being a professional gambler. I know mom and dad were both pretty slow to come around to that. And even Christy's family in general society, you know, it's kind of one of those things that I was a bit shameful for a while, but you know, we both kind of had the same mindset, which was how do we get out of our, you know, small town and elevate our lives? Because there's nothing wrong with where we came from, but we just had something different in mind for the horizon.
Yeah, for sure. And I remember when you first started playing, it was definitely a lot easier to make a living playing poker, but even in the beginning, I wouldn't say that you were overly successful. Like you still had a factory job. And I remember there was a turning point for me when, you know, cause the factory job was like a good paying job. I think you were like 19 years old, but I wanna say that they were paying you close to $20 an hour, which is like unheard of, but it was dangerous work. You were like in some really like OSHA health
I almost lost my hand.
That was the turning point for me. I remember you came home and told me the story because we were living together. You told me the story where you almost had your hand chopped off by like one of the machines in the whatever it was. What was this place?
So basically I was working on a CNC machine in like a cement mixing factory. We had a burn table and we would burn large pieces of steel.
Yeah. And like something came and like tore your glove even.
Yeah. I was like milliseconds away from losing my hand and it chopped the end of my glove off. That's how close it was.
Yeah, I remember hearing that story. And then the other thing is you would wear these masks and you would come home every single day with like soot all in the mask. And I knew that you were breathing.
Yeah, I would cough it up and it would be black on like a napkin. And
I just remember I remember telling you like, quit that job. Like, I don't want you to play poker for a living, but I don't want you to do this job either. Let's get back into school. Let's start doing these things. And you tried it a little bit, but you didn't really like stick to it. And I remember there was a turning point for me where one day I was at my computer, you know, banging away on some code. And then all of a sudden I started getting sit and go email confirmations that was like, congratulations, you have finished first place in a sit and go. Yeah. And they might even have been heads up sit and goes, but like, obviously I didn't know what was going on right now. Like maybe you're winning one of two person tournaments. For all I knew, you were winning like, you know, hundreds if not thousands of dollars every single time you registered these things.
Yeah, you know, I remember my life has been a journey of seeking approval from, you know, you and dad and the family. And, you know, I can say that very confidently because I love you guys so much. And I wanted always you guys to be proud of me. And I remember wanting that. And I just feel like sending you those things, I was like, look, hey, you know, maybe this is something that maybe it's not what you think, or maybe I could be successful at this thing. So,
I said, it was a turning point for me because I remember seeing those and thinking, okay, he can't be lucky 45 times in one day, you know, because they were like first place. And so it must have been heads up, sit and go, something like that. So I came home and I said, how much money did you make today? Show me your account. Like, what are you doing? And you kind of just sat there and walked through it with me. You know, I'm registering these sit and goes. This is how you play. It was back when you could employ like a very simple strategy in these sit and goes and win money. And I remember thinking, wow, okay, this is not luck. Like what you're doing is not lucky. You've figured out a way to exploit these games and you're making money as a result of it. So I remember thinking that was like the first turning point for me. It was like, okay, show me what you're doing.
Yeah. I remember when you kind of got that interest. And you know, for me, it was like such an interesting time to come up in poker because we didn't have any tools available to get better. I mean, there was nothing. So you basically came up with a strategy on your own. And, you know, there were some forums maybe you could go and talk to people and try to, you know, see if you had a good idea. But I basically had no idea what I was doing. I stumbled onto a strategy that I was basically copying off a good player. And it was working for me. And
the other thing is that you were in Fort Wayne, the small town that we were living in, you were making money consistently in those circles. Like you were definitively one of the best players in town. So for me, it was easy to see that you were good. And so I knew that I could just kind of latch on and like sit over your shoulder when I would come home from work and kind of learn the things. And I remember that I deposited money on Bodog and started playing, you know, 25 cent, 50 cent, small stakes, and then also sit and goes to try to like do that and break even. And before I even really started investing any time into it, I was break even and winning a little bit only just from watching you over your shoulder, which is an insane luxury to have. So thank you for that. And it's probably the reason why I'm still playing today is because when I first got into the game, I had someone direct me in a way where I wasn't losing right off the bat. And I think that's actually what kills a lot of players in the beginning is like their first shot that they take or their first tournament or the first time they sit down in a cash game, they get obliterated.
You know, being able to mentor you, being able to help you through that was really important for me. And, you know, when I thought about what I wanted to say today, one thing that I really kind of came to mind was talking about the importance of in my life having mentors. And I had really two key mentors in my development over the years. One was Jonas, an online player from Sweden. Another one was Silas in Vegas, Silas Watson, who's been a good friend as well. And I just can't stress enough how important it is to find people in the industry that you're in that are doing what you want to do, that are successful at it. and people that you get along with, that you enjoy spending time with, and you can provide value to them and they provide value to you on that level, and then you guys, you have fun. Because I remember, you know, as soon as we had met Jonas, my poker career totally changed, because I went from being like a, you know, a guy who kind of understood a lot of the, you know, the nuances of poker and was doing okay, to someone who started to get a more technical feel of the game. And that, to me, to this day, is one of the defining moments of my life.
Yeah, and you met Jonas and Cy in Vegas. But let's rewind a little bit before you went to Vegas, because you were running the scene in Fort Wayne. You know, you were doing well. And Christy had talked about, your wife had talked about wanting to go to Vegas. And talk to me about the trip from Indiana to Vegas, and like, was it smooth? Did you feel like, you know, it was hard, it was easy, or just talk about that a little
bit. So imagine, you know, being, I guess at this time I was probably 20, 21 years old. Christy was 18, 19 years old, and we moved out to Vegas, and basically with no money. I was a 1-3 no limit player with, you know, $500 to my name. And it was hard. It was really tough. So we moved out. Christy got a job working at Card Player, and
which I think was making like what, $10-$12 an hour or something.
It wasn't much, but you know what, it was one of the most exciting times in our lives. Our life was changing so quickly. I met so many people in poker. I was pursuing my dream, you know. I was pursuing my dream of becoming a professional poker player, and as hard as it was really great to be doing it with the woman that I would eventually marry, and in a city that I fell in love with, in a game I was falling in love with, and you know, having you come along. And
yeah, when you made that move, I remember driving out with you to help you guys move all of your stuff.
Yeah.
And it was a cross country trip, you know, 2,200 miles or whatever. And I still had my job, you know, I still was working, and it was the first time in our life that we hadn't lived in the same place. So it was definitely difficult for me to send you off to Vegas, but I knew it was the right progression in your career. Funny enough, me not living with you guys in Vegas lasted 6 months. You guys were there for 6 months, and I was like, I got to go out there. This looks like too much fun. But talk to me about what the grind looked like, what the dream looked like in those first 6 months to a year that you were in Vegas.
Yeah, so basically like being completely broke and trying to learn how to play. You know, at this time I was transitioning from playing tournaments to cash games.
So let me ask you this, about drill down into being completely broke. So when you would bust, would you need to like have Christy like grind out her weekly paycheck to get back in the game, or like how did that credit card debt?
I was overdrawing my account and I was paying fees, you know, and I was going broke all the time, and Christy, we were using her money to basically pay rent. And it was a lot of going broke and a lot of borrowing money. It was very trying time.
One thing that I think people don't understand is that despite going broke all these times, like, you were still actually making good money. It's just staying ahead of life expenses, flat tires, you know, broken windows, health things. Christy had a health scare that cost money. You were renting furniture. It's just expensive. Being bad with money. Yeah. I mean, I know that there were times when we would go to the club and spend multiple hundreds, approaching thousands of dollars after a nice weekend of poker.
On a $600 bankroll, we would be out at the club spending $1,100 like on our credit card.
So you know, you would have like a $4,000, $5,000 month, but at the end of the month, nothing to show for it.
Yeah.
And then when there's nothing to show for it, you can't ride out the ups and the downs. So, yeah. I guess it's definitely a process of getting better with the money. And I remember when I came, that added another level of stability, because I wasn't playing poker yet. I was still working. I got us a house. We all three shared on rent. So that definitely added a layer of getting better. But I don't really think that you had a huge turnaround until you met Jonas at the poker table in Vegas, which was, you were still playing 1-3?
Yeah, I was playing 1-3, and we basically...
How deep was this in your career?
So I mean, this would have been a good 5-6 years into my career. So I was basically playing pretty much 1-3 only up until that point. Mm.
And you met Jonas. Jonas is a Swede from Eskilstuna, Sweden. Shout out to Eskilstuna.
To all my Swedes out there, let's go.
Swedes are the best, man. But you met him at the poker table, and tell me more about that experience of meeting him.
Yeah, so I just remember being, because you basically in life and in poker especially, you, well, I would say in life especially, but also in poker, you have an idea of how things work and you kind of make them to be true. And you're like, I live by these set of rules. This is how I understand this thing. And it was working relatively okay for me. And then when I would sit down at the poker table and play poker with the Swedes, I noticed that they were kind of playing by a different set of rules. And those rules were working better for them than my rules were working for me, meaning they were stacking people with top pair or maybe a weak hand, basically. They were winning big pots and they were getting away from their strong hands without losing much. And I was so interested in it. I was just like so, I just knew that they had figured something out that I hadn't figured out. And it just started as like being so interested. And then they turned out to be the most fun and interesting people.
Well, how did you bridge that gap from, was he sitting close to you? Was he sitting across the table?
Yeah, so they were drinking. And they were like sitting across from the table just having a good time. And I'm a pretty social guy in general, so I just started chatting them up. Mm-hmm. And within a few days, they were basically living with us, remember?
I remember
on
that.
On the Strip.
We were living at Sky on the Strip in a high-rise apartment. And they were in our living room for at least 2 weeks.
Yeah, in their underwear, which is like a very European thing to walk around in your underwear.
Yeah,
not so American. We weren't used to it at the time.
You know, I just got to say it was typical because we're playing poker and we're like trying to grind out a living. And then all of a sudden, my little brother meets these Swedish guys at the poker table. And the next day, they're living in our living room, sleeping in their underwear. And he told me, these guys are really fun. There's somebody that we were going to want to hang around with. And what it actually turned out to be was the catalyst for you exploding your career from, you know, grinding 1-3, going broke and just kind of getting by to a boost into the stratosphere, you know, at a pretty good pace.
Yeah, and the Swedes were so great because it wasn't just that they were teaching me how to play poker. They were teaching me how to have fun, you know? I remember when we would go out, they were just, they had this energy and this idea of being out in the world that was kind of unencumbered. It was like, this is who I am and the world, you know, here I am. And for me, I was much more afraid. I was always worried about, should we do this? Oh guys, I think we're being too extra right now. We need to dial it back. And they were so quick to push me. Oh man, we're fine. We're just having a good time. And they're at the pool splashing and, you know, doing all these things. And
I feel like this is a perfect opportunity to talk about how that affected went into their poker game and made them who they were. Like the way they are in life is also the way they are in poker. So they're loud, they splash around, they get crazy, but at the end of the day, they have more fun, they reap the rewards. And I think that it's an important lesson and a lesson for myself. You know, I've been more of the quiet type, the reserved type, the type that doesn't reach out for help. And it's been affected my career in a way where I've gone the safe road. You know, I've built really slowly, but I haven't had like the highs of the highs, but I also haven't had many of the lows that Swedes will. You know, Jonas has definitely had his lows going out and nights taking the turn for the worse at the roulette table or wherever it may be.
Yeah, but I mean, I think you're so right. And I think the big thing that, you know, I've learned from them is just exactly, it was more than just learning how to be a good poker player. It was learning that as a poker player, I was timid. I was afraid to make mistakes. I was afraid of what other people would think if I did something and it didn't work out. And they would just throw caution to the wind at the poker table. And, you know, it was more of like a lifestyle transformation that really helped me mold who I would become as a poker player. And I can tell you to this day, a lot of the things that kind of plagued me in the beginning of my career, I still deal with. Like I still am afraid to lose. I still, when I get up in a session, I think about and I count the money in my head and I have to kind of like, you know, put those things to the side. And, you know, it's one of those things that the Swedes helped me realize first, and then I was able to continually work on it. But it's something I still deal with today.
Yeah, I think one of the other points that I want to touch on is that Jonas was the first poker player that you started hanging out with that was a lot better than you. Up until that point, you had a poker crew. We all have poker crews when we're coming up, and you were always kind of the leader of the crew. You know, you were the one that define the strategies.
The leader of the riffraff.
You define the strategies. You told someone when they made a bad play, but nobody ever really told you when you made a bad play. Yeah. Nobody ever challenged you to say, that was stupid. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you were that for me because that, which was great, but like nobody was that for you until Jonas came along.
Yeah.
So I think that that was monumental. And then you elevating yourself led to meeting other big players in the space like Sai. Do you even remember how you met Sai?
Yeah, so, you know, living in Vegas, so we lived in Vegas for a good 10 years, and just what is important to me is like being social at the table and connecting with people. I just love it. I love people's stories. I want to know about them. And, you know, in that, I was able to meet a great crew of people in Vegas. I mean, so many great people, and Sai was in that group. And I just kind of, at some point in my career, I realized I got to just like go for it with people. I got to ask for help. I got to say, I don't know what I'm doing. And I did it with him. And, you know, I let him know that he could trust me. I went out and I got staked, and I said, teach me. I don't know what I'm like, I'm your student basically. And it was the best thing I could have ever done. So I continued to kind of keep with the pace of poker, because poker has been evolving a lot. And as you know, has been getting a lot tougher over the years.
I want to touch on staking. Mm-hmm. So you went out and reached out to Sai and offered a business deal, essentially. He knew that you were a talented player, and you knew that you could learn stuff from him. And you thought that it was in your best interest to work out a deal with him that behooved him to stake you, allow you to climb the stakes a little bit faster, learn a little bit. Do you regret this? Do you like the staking model? Is that something that you would go back and do, or did you feel like you could have been better off on your own? Because at the end of the day, you made him a lot of money. Was it worth it?
Yeah, I think it's a great question. And I think a lot of people in the industry don't really, you get a lot of varying answers in this regard. And I will say that for me, it was tremendously worth it, and I would do it all over again. And I believe very much in staking. If it's done correctly, which it's very hard to do correctly, there's just a tremendous amount of trust that needs to be in place. But yeah, I think giving up some equity in the short term on the potential profits I could make, being able to get that knowledge that I could then have for the rest of my poker career, has been infinitely valuable.
Yeah, I want to touch on this as well, because I think that a lot of newer players and people that are new to an industry, they go straight to, how can you help me? Mm-hmm. And I think that that just doesn't work, no matter what it is. If it's poker, if it's business, if it's, you know, you're trying to be the best chef, you don't just go to the best chef and say, help me, you know? Yeah. It's always like a value proposition. And in your case, your friendship and your talent as a player, it just worked in that situation. I think a lot of players in poker will come in and say, how do I get staked by you? And for me, the obvious answer is like, what value are you going to bring to me so that I can reciprocate and bring you value in return? And there have been players like that. Leads us up to now, you have been staked, you started to make some good money, and then the tables turn. Now you start staking, I start staking as a result of us climbing stakes. And do you remember ever picking someone to stake because they just were like, I need you to stake me?
Yeah, it's a good point that you bring up, because that's not really how it works. And I learned a lot about the staking industry. And I will say that for any of you out there that have, you know, wanted to be staked ever or are curious about it, when the way that I've been most successful and the people that I've chosen, they're basically the people that wouldn't allow me to not choose them. I mean, they were the people that, when I was coaching them, they were texting me all the time. They were calling me all the time, trying to set up meetings. And they had that just drive that I saw in them and I knew was gonna be so important. And you know, you gotta have a lot of adversity. You gotta be able to deal with a lot of adversity in poker. So it's not just about being a talented player. And I knew that the kind of people that I wanted in my stable were the kind of people that could get knocked down over and over and over again and keep getting back up. So I would say that, you know, it's really important to put yourself out there and just like, almost like be the annoying one and saying like, hey, you know, I'll do anything. I'll and really just show by your action, because a lot of people think that they would do anything to be staked or anything to be successful. But the truth is that, like, the reason why I'm good at poker and the reason why I've been successful for as long as I have is because I've done the things that other people haven't wanted to do, which is to sit away from the poker table, look at computer programs, get on forums, watch videos. That stuff's boring. Nobody really wants to do that. Mm-hmm. I'd love to be sitting in a game, splashing around with fish, you know, 500 big blinds deep and staying out all night and going to the club and reaping the rewards. But the truth is, like, the money is made in the, you know, off the table. So
yeah, no, definitely. I think that that's actually something that there's been a guy that's been rising through the ranks in the poker world a lot, at least recently. I've met him a couple of times. His name is Landon. I'm sure you're familiar with him.
I don't know, actually. I just saw he's been doing stuff with Joey Ingram.
And your story of what you're talking about perfectly illustrates his trajectory. He was someone that was in Joey's live stream, you know, podcast chats, always providing value, moderating. When the podcast was over, he was providing timestamps. He was doing it all for free. He just wanted to work hard in an industry that he loved. And because he provided value for so many people like Joey and some other big players in the game, now here it is 2 years later, he spent the last 2 years diving into simulations and getting better at poker, helping high profile players in the industry. Now he's being staked by Nick Schulman and Lucky Chewy, and he's on Joey's podcast all the time. It wasn't an accident. It wasn't because he was just sitting around playing online poker and hoping that to get lucky. It was because he wanted it so bad that he put in the work and made himself highly valuable for those people to put him in that spot. So that's exactly what you're saying, and that's exactly what you did. So we started from Indiana, where you were 19 years old, and now we're up to the point of where you're staking other players. This is actually the first point in your poker career and in my poker career where we've not just been a player, we've started the staking, and that's essentially like running a business. So talk to me about what it was like for you managing a business, doing accounting, mm-hmm. managing players, giving time off, giving people raises, you know, writing people up for poor performance. Like, I don't know, what is it? It's your first foray into business, you know?
Yeah. So I think one thing that I had a good sense of right away was that I knew I wasn't very organized or good with numbers. So I had somebody that I could trust that would do all the accounting for me. So that was one of the first things I did. And once I had that in place, the thing that I just knew to be true about business and life, really, I just had a sense for this, was that if I treated these people not like employees, but like they were my children, my family, that I wouldn't have to worry about them stealing. I wouldn't have to worry about them slacking off or you know, a lot of the things that people worry about in staking. So if anything was ever wrong, you know, they were on a downswing, they were having a hard time emotionally with whatever it was they were going through, I just dropped whatever I was doing and I just put all of my energy and focus into it. And I just noticed that the more energy and thoughtfulness and kindness that I put into them, the better they got, but also the harder they worked and the more money they made. So it was like a very healthy kind of give and take system. And it wasn't always the case. There were times when I would notice that I was spending a lot of time playing and then I wasn't really checking in on them, and you know, they had been trying to reach out to me, and it was a process of seeing like, wow, they're really struggling. I need to get back over there and do that because I'm not holding a mind of the bargain. So it was definitely a learning experience.
I think that it's interesting because it's essentially every part of a business. You know, you're the HR, you're also the master trainer, you're the boss, you know, you're the financier of the company. Mm-hmm. And at the most, I think you probably had more than five horses.
Yeah.
That you were managing on your own, playing varying different levels. And like you said, it's just like any company. If an employee is coming into work and they're not happy with the boss, or they're not happy with the terms of their employment, or they feel like they're not getting attention, they're not growing in their role, they're not going to be performing well. So That's the exact same thing that happens with staking poker. My foray into staking poker, I think the most I ever had was two players at once, and then we collaborated on a couple players. But once your business started to grow big, I kind of exited that business and started creating content and going that route. And I think that that's kind of where we diverged a little bit, you know, because up until this point, we had both been playing like 5-10, 10-20, and having similar type results. And then when I started to go down the content creation course and you started staking, there's not a lot of money in content creation. You know?
Yeah, I've heard.
You don't make a lot of money over there.
Yeah.
But you build a brand. So I knew that there was like a bigger picture going on for me when I went down this path. And you had some pretty good success staking some players. And I mean, at the peak, your players were holding hundreds of thousands of dollars for you, making you thousands of dollars.
Probably like close to $500,000 in stake money. And you know, one of the things that I was, it's just expensive to stake people because they need to have money at hand. And you know, when things don't go well, they need to be able to replenish without always knocking on your door. But I had fun with it. Like to me, it was like I had a business and I was able to affect positively these people's lives. And I remember one Christmas, I decided I was going to do something nice for everyone. And I bought finals tickets for a couple of the guys. It was one of the things I did, but I also bought stuff for other people. It was kind of like a Christmas bonus, or like a bonus for people that everyone had been doing well for so long. You know, I wanted to kind of like have the elements of if it were my own business. And, you know, obviously I went with them to the finals and I did a lot of the stuff with them. And it was great because like we've all just become so close. And now I've always told the guys that I've staked, and they've known this from the beginning, was I don't want to stake you. I don't want you to be reliant on this business relationship because I know that you can do this yourself. And I want to get you into a position where you feel comfortable doing that. So over the years, they've taken bigger pieces of their action and I've gotten less, to the point where they're just on their own. So pretty much everyone's on their own now. They've all been able to move off stake. And to me, that's probably one of the best things I've done. But I also wanted to make sure that, you know, in what we're doing now, is that I have this fear that I'm like done a lot of good things in poker. And I don't want that to be my apex. I don't want to look back on my life and be like, well, then I peaked when I was 36 years old. And then everything else was like, you know, whatever. So I'm so happy we're doing this. And I'm excited to really explore a lot of those other things on the horizon so we can continue to push and continue to fail, continue to succeed, continue to learn and to grow. And you know, I'm just like so happy that I'm able to do it with you.
Yeah, I think it really comes down to bandwidth, and the amount of bandwidth that you were spending running a staking business while playing with yourself, while investing in your relationship with Christy, you know, because relationships are work. That create a lot of bandwidth. So doing things like this with me wouldn't even have been feasible a couple years ago, not to mention that we didn't live near each other. But I think that there's this perfect synergy right now with, you know, everything that happened with the pandemic and all of the players that you were staking kind of like going and growing out of that role. Let's talk about the pandemic, first of all, because right before the pandemic happened, you were on a major live downswing. And your staking business had pretty much like ran its course at that point, right? You weren't bringing people on or anything?
Yeah, I was pretty much done. Yeah.
And like, I want to say that for a period of multiple 3 to 4 months, you had not made money, perhaps lost money?
Yeah, I mean, over the course of a year, for me, it was my biggest downswing. Was the first time I'd ever been in the over six figures and what I had lost. And you know, that does a lot to your psyche because, I mean, the dollar amount, whatever, it's more... You know, I was fortunate enough to be able to absorb that and continue to play poker. It's more the going in every day and feeling hopeful and excited that something's going to be different, and then having things not work out, and then exacerbating the issue with making emotional decisions, deviating from my strategy because I'm frustrated, then dealing with that off the table as far as like, wow, I really wasn't able to just keep it together and I'm doing this to myself in some respects. So yeah, it was a very trying time for me. And I feel like I've, you know, the pandemic came in at kind of the perfect time because I just wasn't able to play anymore.
Yeah.
And then I transitioned to playing online, which was really kind of my savior.
Before we hop into you transitioning to online, I know that there was some issues with, because at this point you're playing in the biggest games you can find. You know, you're in the Bay Area playing in uncapped games and basically any big game that you can find in a public forum, which is difficult in 2019 when you were at your apex of live playing live games. You were trying to get in that game. Talk to me about like what the climate had turned into right before the pandemic started and like what how helpful you were with everything going on.
Yeah, so the best games in my opinion in the country were in the Bay Area. And you know, I was able to, I had some friends up there and I would go up and stay with them, and I was going back and forth a lot. And then the games are public. They have like some public games out there, but they also have a huge private scene. And the public scene, you're not really able to play that big only a few days a week. So, you know, but it was enough. And I was able to make friends with, you know, a lot of the people there. And the host is a great guy, Muscle Mike. I'm sure people that have played out there probably know who he is. But yeah, people out there were great. You know, the Silicon Valley people and the regs, everyone, the ecosystem was, I really, really like a lot of the regs that I played with. And, I don't really know how I did overall. I'm sure that they got a lot of my money up there, so maybe I'm always invited. I don't know. They're probably pretty happy I went up there. So,
at this point, the pandemic hits. I mean, you have to be freaking out, right?
Yeah.
You're in a nearly six-figure downswing. The pandemic hits, and there's no more games, period, let alone big games. You're not excited to rush into people's homes to try to like grind out a living. I was there with you, you know, we're live poker players, and I was freaking out. Tell me like what you did immediately. You transitioned.
Well, I mean, I have to be honest, you know, first of all with myself, but you know, being honest to everyone out there, I was never a winner online cash games my whole career. It was something that I knew that I needed to kind of figure out and learn and study more on, which is, as we, I think, kind of all know now, is like the very technical side. If you can be successful online, you can pretty much be successful doing anything. And I had a couple attempts and they had all failed. But now I was kind of like...
Prior to Black Friday?
Prior to pandemic.
Oh, so you had dabbled online.
I had tried a few times, maybe a good three or four times. Like, I'm really going to sit down and try to learn this. And I would go in and then I would get too frustrated and I would lose. And I would eventually just go back to playing live.
So you need to generate upwards of $15,000 a month in income playing poker. And you've already struggled. You've had a history of struggling with online poker. And now the pandemic happens. I mean, it had to be scramble mode.
Yeah, but that's what I mean, that's such a powerful thing that human beings that we can do, is that when we put our back against the wall, like when you're just forced to figure something out, we're just so much more effective. And I don't think, you know, I was never really in that position where I was forced to really stick with it and really focus in the way that I was after the pandemic hit. So I just spent so much time, you know, working on a lot of the computer programs and watching a lot of videos, talking to my other good online player poker friends. Finding the right player pools to play in online also is a big part of it. And it's something I'm really proud of, is like being able to be a good winner online, because it was something that I really struggled with for a very long time. But yeah, so I have been able to transition successfully so far.
So basically the last 9 months then has been spent just grinding online. Yeah. And I know this is something that is interesting. I know you've done well because you've been kicked out of some clubs. And they don't kick out losers, you know?
Yeah.
So that's another challenging thing with the current climate of online poker. If you make too much money, and this is just so funny to me, because I remember when I got you into these clubs, I told you to play like a fish. I said, play poorly. Mm-hmm. You know, play weird pre-flop, do some weird things, and let's ride this out as long as you can. And you did. You're like, I'm playing like a fish, and I still crushing everyone, and they kick me out.
Yeah.
So it's really interesting. But yeah, I think that kind of leads us up to where we are now. You are in San Diego on a consistent basis. I'm in San Diego on a consistent basis. This is one of the first times that we've been around each other for a considerable amount of time in a living situation, not traveling as much as I have been in the past. And we are both really interested in kind of taking this thing to the next level in terms of our life. You know, we've both been poker players. I've been a content creator. You've been running a staking business, online player. And I think one thing that really interests us both is just the process of figuring out how to make money. And we've been dabbling in, you know, starting businesses, dabbling in learning about the market, dabbling in crypto, just all kinds of things related to business. And I think that we have a unique perspective in terms of our poker minds that we can offer the audience a lot of value in the things that we learn and the things that we do to basically hack life, to hack business with our game theory mind.
You know, one of the things that I'm excited to bring to the channel is just a lot of the experience and the mistakes that I've made. You know, being able to be successful in poker for almost 20 years, there's a lot of mistakes that I've made. I've had to figure out a lot of interesting problems, not just with how to become good at poker, but how to become successful in life, how to manage money, how to handle like extreme adversity, how to handle being broke. And I think being able to provide people with a lot of those experiences, and if hopefully people could learn from some of the mistakes that I've made and benefit from some of the things that we've learned, I just think I think it'll be great for them to learn those things.
What you're really going to get with this conversation are the things that we're learning about week to week. And you know, for example, we see an opportunity on the Super Bowl this weekend, and we're going to be betting $20,000 on the Super Bowl. And yeah, we're not professional sports bettors, but we found an angle and we have access to some data that we think we're going to be able to be profitable this weekend. So that's just one example. You know, our money is basically always in play. You know, we have speculative things that we have going on in the stock market, speculative things that we have going on in crypto, different businesses that we're investing in. And this forum to talk about it, I think, is going to be, you know, talk about our mistakes, talk about our triumphs, and it'll be something that it'll be good for me to just connect with you on a week-to-week basis so we can like go over some of this stuff.
Well, I could say one thing too about what I think we could expect from the channel. I think, you know, to me, one thing that we do a lot as professional poker players that is going to be very present in what we do moving forward is that we just understand what EV is and expected value and equity and how to pursue it. Where is it? Is it there? Is it still there? Is it not there anymore? And a lot of times in what you're saying with the Super Bowl is like, we're not professional sports bettors, but we can see that we have an edge because of, you know, this thing that we're doing. And, you know, that's as you're saying, one example, but there are many examples of finding inefficiencies in the market or looking at where potentially, you know, where poker, we had huge edges all over the place all the time. And, you know, now those edges are few and far between and they've shrunken a lot. And so that's basically what we do, is we just look for edges. We talk about them and we share them in the public forum. And I think people can expect to come in here and hear about different opportunities, different ways that we're looking at different markets. And I think it'll be a fun exploration doing it with you and bringing everyone along.
Yeah,
with
while
us.
While you're actually the person that I'm interviewing in this particular episode, it's going to be different people from different, you know, different avenues of life. It's not just going to be me and you having a conversation each week. So you can expect different guests that are experts in different fields that basically tie into what you're talking about, inefficiencies in market and learning and figuring out ways to capitalize and make money. Figuring out ways to make money, but the thing is that no matter what you do, it's gonna be a grind. And that's why I love the title of the show, Embrace the Grind, is because it's just gonna be learning, grinding. If it doesn't work, you know, figuring out what didn't work about that, coming back to the drawing board, trying something new next week, but it's always gonna be a grind. And the way that grinding works is it goes down, it goes up, it goes down, it goes up, but eventually, you know, it has an upward trend. So episode one of Embrace the Grind is in the books. Thank you so much for joining me, Andrew Moreno. I think what we'll do for this particular one is after this episode airs, we'll go on Clubhouse and host a talk, me and you, where people can ask questions about, you know, poker, what we're up to, how our Super Bowl bets are doing, how staking works, whatever questions you have. Follow me on Clubhouse and we will host a Q&A. Thank you guys for joining us on Embrace the Grind. Do you have anything to say?
I just want to add one thing. I just wanted to give everyone one, you know, more reason why they should, you know, think, well, why should I follow this guy? Like, what does he know about business? What does he know about marketing and all these things? Well, the reason why is this guy right here, you know, when he was 7, 8 years old, he was coming home with, you know, $10, $20 in dollar bills in his pocket, and we were dirt poor. My mom was like, where are you getting all this money from? You know, like, you're like, I don't have it. You're obviously getting it somewhere. Someone's giving it to you. This guy right here was selling, he was going to the store and buying blow pops, and he was flipping them at school. So he would sell them for like a quarter a piece, and they were costing him like a couple pennies at the time. And he was making all this money. Yeah. He's coming home with all this money. So you have been an entrepreneur, whether you realized it or not. You have been an entrepreneur since you were a little kid, and you're just, you know, I'm excited to be doing this with somebody who's in their DNA.
Yeah, no, definitely. And if you're, you know, if you're listening to this on a podcast format, we're going to be on all of the, you know, Spotify, you know, iTunes, all that stuff. But we also have a video version of this. If you want to watch it on YouTube, the channel is going to be called Embrace the Grind. Not only will it be these long form interviews, about 45 minutes to an hour, I'll probably release a fun vlog format version of videos that are not this format of talking on that channel as well. It's going to be all things grinding, all things making money, all things looking for angles and looking for ways to exploit. And yeah, so thanks again. Love you, bro.
Love you, man.
We'll be back next week. This is going to be a weekly thing. So to everyone that's watching, embrace the grind. And we'll see you soon. I'ma give it all I got, all I got, like grinding.